Hello and welcome to Kimber Bushcrafts. Well, today I'm in my camp, as you can see, and the weather is not particularly good. There's lots of clouds and no sun and a little bit of rain. And the wind is coming from the east, and that is the most annoying angle it can come from, because it blows down in my camp and makes a lot of noise here. So I hope you can hear what I'm saying. This video will be about question and answer, and I'll answer your questions that I have received in the comment section. So, but now I'm drinking from my Viking horn. It's actually a horn I've had many years. I got it from my sister, I think 15, 20 years ago, and I never used it. So this is my first time in my video from the dark forest. I used another drinking horn, a smaller one. It was too small, so this one is perfect. So skål. Yeah, and I copy the comments, the questions on the comment section, and print it out on paper, so I read it up from there and answer your question as good as I can. And because I'm an old man, I have to wear my glasses if I have to see something. Well, there were not that many questions, and I think that's because many of you already know a lot of stuff about me, but there were some, I think about 20 questions, and many of them were of the same subject. But I'll take all those that I think is interesting. And the first question is, what kind of job do you have? Well, I would like to tell you a little story about my working life. After school I was a sailor, and I got to a sailor school in Frederikshavn here in Denmark, and I was sailor about 3 years, and then I ended up in the Navy. I was there for a year, and after that I got on a photographing school, a school where you can learn to photograph. And I was actually a professional photographer for many years, about 25 years. And after the 25 years, I decided to change my life and do other stuff than just photographing. So I was lucky to have a job on a place where young people come to live if they can't live at their parents. Perhaps they have problems with drugs or crime, or just couldn't fit in the normal society. And on that place, it's a house where they lived, and I was there a couple of days a week and slept there and eat with them. And of course my work was to make them fit into the society, to give them some perspective and some tools so they could navigate around in the society and be ordinary people with ordinary jobs and so on. And there I was 13 years, and then the workplace that I was on had to close because there was not enough young people there, so I had to find out something else. And then I was lucky to get a job on the school where I helped the school with those of the children that had problems, social problems, behavior problems, and so on. And again, the job was to help them to be better, to function in school, or perhaps find another school that was more suitable for them. So that's the story about my working life. The job I had is a little bit as a therapist. We call it a pædagog here in Denmark, and it's much about talking to the children and trying to change the mind settings and so on. And I think it's a very interesting job. And now to the next question. How long ago you got started in bushcraft, or what got your interest in bushcraft? Well, I've been an outdoor person for my whole life. When I was about 10 years old, I have a neighbor's boy, a few years older than me, that took me out in the woods and taught me a lot of things about the nature. we were watching birds and just relaxing out in the woods. And there it started my interest in the outdoor living. And since I later became a photographer, of course, I went a lot of trips out in the woods and in the forest and in nature, and took a lot of pictures there. And well, I always have been camping with my family, and primitive camping, where we make fire and cook the food over the fire and so on, and slept on the ground. So that's the way that I have spent almost all my holidays. And of course, I have made some trips. I also have made a canoe trip to Sweden many years ago, and I have been hiking in Norway too. But the interest for bushcraft came for me about 5 years ago, when I started to watch YouTube and watch the movies or the videos about bushcrafting there. And then I said to myself, that's exactly what I'm going to do, and I'm going to dream about making out in the woods. And there was a lot of new opportunities. I could start carving in woods and make leatherworks and so on. And for about, I think it's 3 years ago, 3-4 years ago, I started my YouTube channel. And of course, it's because I'm a photographer, and I like taking pictures and also make videos. So that's the way I started in bushcraft and in my YouTube career.
And the next question,
do you have a favorite bushcrafting memories? Well, that's hard. I have a lot of great memories for all my bushcrafting, especially the mornings when I wake up and can see the sun rising over the forests, or looking out on the fire in the evening. But many of my trips, my hikes in Norway, I really appreciate that, because Norway is so wonderful country to hike in. Here in Denmark, we don't have mountains at all, and very few rivers and streams. So in Norway, I think in Norway, that's my best memory from bushcraft.
Let's hear the next question.
Is there anything particular you enjoy the most about it? I think bushcrafting suits me very well, because I like to make handcrafted stuff, and that's perfect when you are practicing bushcraft. You see in my videos, I make my leather stuff, most of my leather stuff, sell myself, and also make some carvings, cooker and spoons and so on. And when I'm here in my camp, I can use that when I'm making my camp, all the furniture you have seen. So for me, it's perfect to practice bushcraft.
And the next question, has it been as you had expected?
Yes, of course. I hadn't expected that my YouTube channel will be as it is now, with almost 30,000 subscribers. I'm very grateful for that. But the process in practicing bushcraft is just what I had expected. I can evolve and I can be better for certain things, and practicing making fire and so on. I think it's very cool, and I love it very much.
Do we have some gear that I haven't tested yet and would like to have?
Yes, of course, there's many knives that I haven't tested yet and would like to have them, try them out. And as I told you before, I'm going to make a camp here, a shelter, and in that shelter I would like to have some kind of wood stove that I can have in there, and I can have it warm and cozy there, like a wood stove in a hot tent. And actually, I have a contact to a company that makes those wood stoves, and they are really awesome. And I would like to have one of those, and I'm corresponding with them, and I think I will get one soon, and then I can put it up in my shelter, and then I can stay here even during the winter and still keep warm. And I also have plan of buying one of those Polish lavoos that I can take out with me in the forest, and then I can bring the stove to and use it in that too. And of course, there's many other things I would like to have. I like gear, I love gear, and you all know that.
And I think most of you agree with me that it's great to have a new piece of gear and try it out in the forest or in the nature and see how it works. One have to be careful not that the gear is the only thing that's driving you when you're going out in the woods. You have to enjoy staying out here, you have to enjoy being in the nature, and you have to enjoy just the quietness. So for me it's very important that I don't focus a lot, most of my attention around the gear. And I'm thinking a lot about that, and I'm trying not to let my bushcraft be guided by gear only, but also the experience of being outdoors. And now about my leather works. How long have you been working with leather? Well, I can remember back for about 30 years ago, I made some leather works. I made a sheath for a Bowie knife I have, and made a lot of other stuff. So I've been working with the leather for many years, but it's only in the last 2 years that I really have evolved in that process, because I got a contact to a place where they sell leather and all the tools that I can use when I'm making leather works. And that's one of the reasons why I have evolved and developed my skills, because it's very difficult to get leather. And I know a lot of you subscribers are telling me that they can't find leather any places. So here in Denmark we have a few places, and the one I use is called Læderiet, and it's down in Aarhus, 100 kilometers from where I live. And sometimes I drive down there and I buy leather and other stuff. If I didn't have that, I think not I have would have made as many leather projects as I do now. How did you learn to work with leather? Did you teach yourself? Yeah, I did. I did teach myself. I didn't have anything to look at. 30 years ago there were no internet like now, so I could probably have borrowed a book from the library or something, but I just went ahead and did it, and I learned along the way. Now there's a lot of instructions, video on the internet, and I watch some of them and I get some ideas from that, and you can learn a lot of the basic skills about leatherworking. And if you're not seeing those videos, I think you should go in and check them out. There's a lot of good videos out there, and also the carving. I've learned a lot from carving videos, and I like carving too in wood and so on. Is this related to your occupation, or is it just something you taught yourself? Well, that's the same question again. It's not anything to do about my occupation. I have taught it myself, and I think everyone can do that to a certain level. Of course, you have to have some talents, and I think that my good eye as a photographer, and I can focus, I can think in pictures, it's very good for me, and I can use that when I make my leather craft and my wood craft. And then to the next question, is it not heavy to carry all those unnecessary things like fibula and other stuff? And well, of course you can hike out in the woods with less gear than I bring with me. I almost always have my rucksack on my bag, and well, of course it's a little bit heavy, about 12 kilos or so, but a lot of the stuff I have in my rucksack I can easily find a reason why I should have them with me. I have besides, just wrote it down here, first of all, I have my first aid kit with me, and then I can't let that be home, so I have to have some kind of first aid kit with me. And I also always have my carving tools with me. If I'm out in the woods and I suddenly have a need for carving something, I always bring that with me too. And I also have my compass, multi-tool, and some other stuff that I can use. A paracord I also always bring with me. And a tinder pouch with all my tinder in, and a little pouch with some dry woods that I can use if I can't find suitable dry woods in the forest. And then I also bring my reindeer skin or fur with me, so I can sit out on the ground, and if the ground is wet, I always have my ground claws from B&W Bushcraft with me. And all that weighs a lot, and it's not compact. And then I also have some cooking gear with me. I also have my kettle, coffee and water and so on. And all that also takes up some space. And I also have my saw and my axe with me, and a wood stove. And now I've changed for a period my solar stove out with my essential bushcraft bush box. And that's it's a bit smaller, so now I have more room for other stuff. And in the winter here, I can bring a warm sweater with me too. And I also have a poncho in my rucksack if it's going to rain and so on. So there's a lot of stuff in my rucksack I think I like to bring with me when I'm out on my hikes. And of course, it weighs a lot. Only my even my rucksack is very heavy. And if you're going old school, you have to know that it is all very heavy stuff. Not like the new stuff that is lightweight, titanium and light fabrics and so on. So if you're going old school, you have to accept that it weighs a bit more, maybe a lot more. And that's a part of the game, I think. And of course, I also have a lot of camera equipment with me. I also always have two cameras and two tripods. And they are also taking up space in my rucksack. So most of you are going to can easily understand bringing a haversack can't hold all those items. So for me, it's a very important to have my rucksack with me. And I don't think it's heavy. 12 kilos on my back, I can't feel it. And of course I don't walk, hike long distances, maximum 10 kilometers and so. So it's not a problem. If I'm going to hike 20 kilometers per day in a week, I don't think that rucksack will be suitable for that. So, now to the next question. What is your favorite sleep system? Do you prefer to be on the ground or in the hammock? I don't like to sleep in the hammock. I always sleep on the ground with my sleeping pack, hat and my sleeping bag. And that's the way I like it. And the next question. What is the best oil to use for finishing a cooktop or a utensil? What do you use? I've used food oil for many years, just ordinary olive oil and so, but lately I've tried some stone oil, and I think that's is the best solution, and I'm going to do that from now on. Stone oil, well, it's oil that you can put on stones, granites, I think it's called, other types of stones that are going to dry out. And it's very suitable for wood because it makes a hard surface on the woods, and it doesn't take much of the dirt when you're out, easy to clean. And for me, I found out that stone wood is the best solution, and I'm going to use that in the future. And then, what do you do to settle your coffee grounds? Sometimes I use a splash of cold water. Yeah, and I used cold water too for some months ago. After I changed my coffee brand to Lemel, the coffee from Sweden, I don't put in cold water anymore. And actually, I haven't noticed any difference about that. For me, it's not a problem with the coffee grounds in the coffee. I just don't drink the last bit of my coffee in my kuxa, and certainly not the last coffee in my kettle. And if you only watch out, I don't think it's a problem. I see some people hitting on the kettle to make the grounds sink to the bottom. So I don't do that. I just cook it about a minute or so and let it rest for about a minute. And then I pour the coffee up. And for me, it's not a problem. So I don't have a solution for that. If cold water works for you, that's fine. I've found out that for me, it doesn't make a difference. Next question. What cameras do you use when filming? And do you use separate microphones or the built-in microphones? I started using a GoPro camera, GoPro Hero 3, I think it's called, when I first started out bushcrafting YouTube videos. And it's an awesome camera. And then I bought the GoPro 6. And I must admit, I'm not as fond of that as the GoPro 3. The sound in the GoPro 6 is very bad, so I have a microphone on top of it, and that makes it a little bit better. But because I can't zoom in the GoPro, I have bought 2 years ago, I bought a Canon M100. That's a very great camera, I think. I like it very much, and the camera that I'm filming with now, and most of my videos are made with that camera. It's a great camera. It's compact, and I have a zoom in it, and a screen that I can flip up so I can look at myself when I'm filming. And it's not on the side of the camera. If I'm looking at the side, you can see I'm not looking at you. If I'm looking here, I'm looking at myself, but I'm almost looking at you too. So Canon M100, I can strongly recommend that. It's an awesome camera and very easy to work with. And I don't have an external microphone. I use the microphone on the camera. The GoPro has an inbuilt camera, but that doesn't work good, so I bought a microphone that I have attached on top of the GoPro, and that works okay. And my Canon has a great microphone that I'm using right now. This is going to be a long talking video. I'm sorry for those of you who doesn't like talking videos. But again, lots of questions, and I know some of you are interested in a lot of these things. Tell us a bit about your smoking, your pipes and tobacco you like. I love taking my long pipe with me. The whole ritual is cleaning it, packing it, lighting it up and smoking it. Yeah, and all that. And yes, that's right. I do smoke a pipe, and I've had a lot of pipes during my time. A lot of Danish pipes too. But recently I found out that Savinelli, an Italian pipe, a place here in Aalborg where I live, they have Savinelli pipes that are reasonable priced, and I have bought those. They were great pipes, and all of my pipes now is made from Savinellis. I'm using that. And regarding my tobacco, I smoke a tobacco called Red Orlik Golden Slice tobacco. I think it is for sale in most countries. I know that some of you have told me that you can buy it in your country. Yeah, I don't know if it's all over the world, but here in Denmark it's a very popular tobacco. It's not cheap and it's not expensive. It's just in the middle, and I think it's a great tobacco and love it very much. Some months ago I tasted a tobacco from the USA, Captain Black, I think it's called. One of my subscribers, Shem, sent me one pack of those, and I must say I was very fond of that too. So I know that Shem is going to send me some more tobacco. I'm really grateful for that. and I'm looking forward to receiving that, because it's another type of tobacco than Red Orlik. It's more sweet and light tobacco to smoke, but I love it very much. So it's very nice to have different tobaccos to choose from. And one thing I noticed about this question was about, you are talking about the ritual. I actually got a question from a subscriber some time ago. It had nothing to do with this video, but he was asking me, why are you YouTubers using so lot of time making your fire? And of course, a lot of the time in my videos and other YouTuber videos is about making fire, making my coffee, making food and so on. And you can do it easier and faster. You can light a match and some dry newspapers and some dry wood, and then you will have a fire in no time. But for me, and I think it's for many of you YouTubers or bushcrafters, it's about the ritual. When you are making your fire, it's an old ritual that have been used for a thousand of years. And the same with the coffee for me. It's something that I like to do, and when I do it, I feel relaxed and I feel a little bit bound to nature and bound to my ancestors, all the way to the Viking Age and the Stone Age. So for me, the ritual of making a fire and coffee and food and so on, it's very important, and I would like to show you in my videos. The next question: do you ever use any wild herbs or plants when you are camping? Yes, I do. In my camp here, I have a lot of blackberries, and I collect them and eat them. When I find suitable mushrooms out in the forest, I collect them and use them. I'm not an expert in mushrooms, so I only harvest those that I'm sure that it's not poisoned. And I've used some leaves from, I think it's called dandelions, for sandwiches and so on. And I also used stinging needles to making tea. And of course, my chaga that I love, my chaga coffee, is also something that I harvest. And I actually made a video about medicinal plants. Then you can go and look in that. I tell you about some of the options you have when you're out in the woods, in the nature. You can collect and the benefits those herbs and plants have. So yes, I'm using the nature when I can. What is your favorite knife? And I think a year ago or so, I made a video about, I was tagged about that issue, what is your favorite knife, and I told you about that then. But I can say now, if I should pick my three favorite knives, of course it's my SE5. I love that knife, I have it for many years. And I also love my neck knife, that was the Ötzi knife, but unfortunately I dropped it somewhere in the forest and I can't find it again. So then I had to find another knife that I can use for a neck knife. And then I thought about, well, I have this, the Viking knife from Helle. And it's a knife I made a review of from Lamia, a very nice company. And now I made it so it can be a neck knife for me. And I put a little decoration on here. Perhaps it's more like Indian than Viking, but I love it. So this is my new neck knife, and I love that knife. And now I can use it. It's carbon steel and Scandi grind, so I can use that for feather sticks and so on. I have to practice a little bit more with feather sticks, because I am not as good at that, and my SE5 is not a great tool for that. So now I'm going to practice with my Viking knife from Helle. So. And the last knife, if I should mention three, is my carving knife from Mora. It's a very nice little knife. It's sharp and it's pointed, and I can use it for the fine carving too. So that is my favorite three knives at the moment. And then there was a subscriber who was asking me about my sheath. This one I have in the front here, and maybe other have noticed that and wondering what it was. And the place was meant to be for a ferro rod, a small ferro rod, but I like my big one that's down here. So up here I actually got an awl. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but it's a pointing a little thing that I can use for many purposes. And I even got a surface here that I can use as a striker. But a little awl, I think, is suitable for many things. And it's very cool to have it down here. So it's not a little knife. It's just something I can use additional for my knife. And then I think it's the last question now. Let's see. Yeah, that fishing reel was a cool build. What will the next how to do project be? I have a lot of ideas in my head. All the time I got new ideas and things I want to try. So I can't say what the next project will be, but of course there will be some new projects. And now I'm going to build my shelter here. Actually, I have received the documentation that I allowed to make the shelter, and I probably will start that during the week, perhaps the next weekend and so. And when I'm going to build that, I have a lot of projects, so I can make it really cool. Not the shelter itself, but the way I can use it inside with small tables and so on. So I'm very much looking forward to that, and I have a lot of ideas what I can do about that and with it. So that's exciting. And of course I always have some leather projects and antler projects too that I'm working on. And when I think it's something new, I'll definitely make a video about it and show you how I did it. And regarding the antler, I know a lot of you have asked me where I find my antler and say that it's very difficult to find. And yes, it is very difficult. And even the place down in Aarhus where I buy my leather, they have antler, but it's not from a red deer. It's from reindeer, and that's not so cool antler. So the antler I have bought now, I actually find in pet shops. And shops that sells food and toys and so on to people that have pets, dogs and cats and rabbits and so on. And they are meant to be for the dogs' chewing bones. And well, here in Denmark, there's a lot of choices and a lot of cool antler pieces that I have bought there. It is not particularly expensive. So perhaps you should try that in your country. Go to a pet shop and see if they have some of the antlers that you can use for a good project. Well, this is all the question I had. I'm very grateful for all the interest you are showing me and my channel. And I'm very grateful for all the new subscribers I got here. My video Dark Forest have been a great hit. At the moment I think it's 45,000 views. I usually get about 4,000 or 5,000 views per video, depending how lots of things, but that video is really hitting and have brought a lot of new subscribers for me. I'm very grateful for that, and I welcome you all. If you have any questions, just ask me in the comment section, of course. I'm not only answering questions in this video. So now, well, it's not a good weather today, and I'm not sure I'm going to make my my coffee here. I don't know, I have to see. So I think you must excuse me. I have a nice beer here from Denmark. Svaneke Stout is from Bornholm, the island that I visit during my holidays. You can watch that video. My sister and brother-in-law is living there. A very great beer and a stout black beer. I like that. So, and this drinking horn is perfect for that. So, for the first time, I'm going to make my with a cup of good Danish stout. Skål. Nice. Well, this was all for now, folks. I hope you enjoyed this little video and my question and answer. As I said before, I'm going to start my building project soon with my shelter here and my camp, and I'm looking very much forward to that. I'm trying not to only make videos about that in the future, in the near future. I have planned a hike for a very special place, and I think you would like that. And again, it will be a video without any talk. I talked a lot in the video, and I hope you will excuse me for that. But again, thank you for watching Kimber Bushcraft. I really appreciate that, and I appreciate all your support and all the new subscribers that have found my channel. I'm very grateful for that. I hope you're having a nice weekend, and I hope to see you again on the next one. Bye-bye. Take care.
Skal du gøre sådan her? Du skal lige få det fluffet lidt op, ikke også?
Men det er dig, der kommer til at puste det ligesom sidste gang.
Nej, du er dig, der puste den sidste gang. Kan du ikke huske det?
Nej, det var dig, der stod sådan.
Men det går jeg først. Kan du slet ikke huske det, Tristan? Nå. Du var så stolt, fordi du faktisk gjorde det hurtigere end mig. Jeg husker det lige så tydeligt. Det må jeg indrømme.
Var det ikke fordi, jeg gjorde det sådan med et kæmpe pus?
Jeg ved ikke, hvad du gjorde. Det var derfor, jeg gerne lige vil se igen. Jeg vil gerne have det på video.
Jamen, jeg ved ikke, om jeg kan gøre det igen.
Nej, jeg ved det godt, Tristan.
Det er ikke klikker.
Det her er heller ikke en konkurrence, vel? Det er simpelthen... Nu får jeg lige det her arrangeret til dig. Vi tager lige og hiver et lidt stykke af her.
Og så, en lille brændt knud.
Og herovre, der var der et godt sted. Så du holder den her med fingeren sådan der, så der lige kommer lidt der, og så skal du tage den, og så skal du slå ned, ligesom okay. Du gjorde sidste gang.
Jeg prøver ikke så hovedsigt. Altså, filmer du nu?
Hvad siger du?
Filmer du overhovedet?
Jeg filmer nu, ja. Lidt længere ud til kanten, tror jeg. Ja, derude. Så prøver vi at se. Nok slå lidt hårdere, der skal være lidt mere. Vil du sidde og øve dig lidt på stenen først?
Ja.
Så tag det væk, det der sjarklod. Så prøv lige at se, om du kan få.
Det er fordi, jeg ikke er så god til det.
Ved du hvad, man skal jo lære det, ikke også? Det er derfor, da jeg skulle starte på det her, var jeg heller ikke god til det.
Altså, er det sådan, man holder sådan her, eller hvad?
Ja, men det, sidste gang, der fik jeg nemlig, der har lært det. Er du ved at, ja, nu er du ved at være der. Wow!
Der kom gnister.
Der kom mange gnister. Så prøver vi lige.
And now I'm gonna try with
this. Ja, og så tæt på der. Ja, lige præcis.
Nogle gange kommer der gnister.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, jeg slår et stykke af der.
Ja, vi prøver lige med et nyt her, fordi jeg tror... Ja, vil du prøve et nyt, eller hvad?
Ja.
Det kommer til at gå lidt i stykker, det der. Prøv at se, om du kan med det der. Sådan. Det er godt, det der. Ja, du har en! Se den! Pus den! Så tag den her ned i. Det er godt. Og er du dygtig! Og så skal jeg lige hjælpe dig her. Nu kan jeg godt tage det der. Nu har vi lige lidt tid her. Du holder den selv.
Den er ikke ild.
Jo, der er. Bare rolig. Og så husk at komme den her ned, når den begynder at brænde, ikke? Hvor er det flot?
Kan du ikke putte den der lidt tættere på mig?
Jo. Tristan! Mesteren! Mesteren!
Jamen, du skal bare puste lidt hårdt. Hvem der er en glød op ved dig?
Ja, skidt om det. Du skal ikke lige komme her og fortælle mig, at du ikke kan det her. Du er jo faktisk imponerende god til det. Nå.
Men jeg er ikke lige så god som dig.
Jo, det er du faktisk. Ja. Nu skal vi se, om vi kan få noget gang i den. Du kan bruge dem her. De er dem, som er rigtig gode til at give ild. Så det tog, det tog lidt længere tid, eller lidt kortere tid, end her to triste. Du er faktisk super god til det.